You're listening to the B&H Photography Podcast. For over 40 years, B&H has been the professional source for photography, video, audio, and more. For your favorite gear, news, and reviews, visit us at bnh.com or download the B&H app to your iPhone or Android device. Now here's your host, Alan Weitz.
Greetings and welcome to the B&H Photography Podcast. 60 years ago, on the morning of August 12, 1958, a young magazine art director shooting what would be the first assignment of a colorful photographic career gathered together the who's who of the jazz world, 57 musicians to be exact, for a group portrait on 126th Street in Harlem. To this day, the photograph most commonly known as A Great Day in Harlem remains a symbol of community and specifically African-American pride. 40 years later, and 20 years ago, on September 29, 1998, about 200 hip-hop artists came together to create an updated version of Art Kane's famous jazz portrait. It was to be the cover for XXL Magazine, and it was called The Great Day in Hip-Hop. The person who clicked the shutter was none other than Gordon Parks, which is about as fitting as it gets. Today we're going to be talking to some of the people who produced this recreation of the now classic portrait Art Kane took all those years ago. Joining us in the studio are Vikki Tobak and Michael Gonzales. Vikki is a past guest on our show, a journalist, producer, and most recently the author of the upcoming book, Contact High, A Visual History of Hip-Hop. Michael Gonzales is a writer and journalist whose work has appeared in The Village Voice, Longreads, Pitchfork, and Mass Appeal. Michael is also the co-author of Bring the Noise, A Guide to Rap Music and Hip-Hop Culture. He's currently putting the finishing touches on Boom for Real, a New York City hip-hop novel. We're also going to be joined via Skype by Sheena Lester, the then-editor of XXL Magazine, who is instrumental in producing A Great Day in Hip-Hop, the photograph at the center of today's show. Last but not least, we're going to be joined by visual and creative artist and filmmaker Fab Five Freddy, whose list of accomplishments is simply too long to read in one sitting, but most notably, he's known for being the original host of Yo MTV Raps. It's also worth mentioning that we plan on interviewing musician and photographer Jonathan Kane, the son of photographer Art Kane, in an upcoming episode of our show when he'll be sharing thoughts and further insights about his father's iconic photograph. Stay tuned for further details. For now, where do you want to start over this, John?
Sheena, why don't you start? My first question would be, whose idea was it to get Gordon Parks involved and how did that work?
The original idea for the photograph, it came from someone before I arrived at XXL, in terms of just the actual retaking of the photo. The sales boss, a guy by the name of Jonathan Reingold, and his lovely wife, it was their idea. And Dennis Page, the publisher, shot it down at the time, saying it was just too early. I guess the suggestion was that they use it for their launch cover to retake the photo using hip-hop artists. So, you know, the idea went away. Once I became editor-in-chief, somebody brought it up in a meeting, and the idea of us not being able to do it never occurred to me. Like, of course we could do it. We came back to Dennis with it, and he was all in. And then a gentleman by the name of Michael Gonzales came up with the idea of Gordon Parks, and he slipped it to this beautiful woman, Leslie Pitts, who co-produced the shoot with us. She and a gentleman by the name of Biff Warren, who were two of the most amazing publicists I'd ever worked with in my life. And, you know, they'd know who to get, you know, without, you know, any super direction from our part. You know, they knew what we were doing. They knew who we wanted. So, you know, they'd know who to get. So anyway, Michael suggested it to Leslie. She brought it to me. And it was, you know, again, an ingenious idea. And then, you know, the stars made it happen. I was actually out with a friend at a museum, and Leslie called and said that Gordon Parks said no. And then I called him and got him to change his mind. The rest is history.
Well, Michael, why don't you chime in here? Tell us a little bit about, you know, how that thought came to you. And
well, I was born and raised in Harlem, and I had been my mom has always been into art and photographs and that kind of stuff. So I knew who Gordon Parks was. I also knew his films. I had, you know, seen Shaft. I think that was the first album I ever bought was Shaft. And I remember pictures of Gordon Parks in the gatefold of the album with Isaac Hayes, and he was just always so cool. There was an HBO special that was on, so his name was in the air, and, you know, I had seen the show, and so I just kind of threw it out there. Mm-hmm. Like, I never really thought it was going to be possible.
That's the best way to approach things often.
Totally. Yeah.
So I threw it out there, and Leslie loved the idea, and she took it to Sheena, and they made it happen. Right. I mean, you know, recently Sheena wrote an essay about that day that I read, and, you know, when she talks about how, you know, because Gordon turned them down twice, and and then Sheena put the golden voice on him, and then he changed his mind.
Were there other photographers considered, or plan Bs, or how'd that work?
Not that I know of. I guess because there were a lot of quote unquote hip hop photographers at the time, you know, The Source, Vibe, and now XXL, you know, so there were all these photographers that could have been called on, you know. I mean, my favorite photographer from that period was Daniel Hastings, and, mm-hmm. you know, but there were, you know, any number of guys that could have done it. But, you know, I knew if Gordon was involved, that would become, you know, like...
That adds a whole level of gravity to it, seriously.
Having him on board made a difference, and maybe this is for Sheena, in getting folks to attend who might otherwise not have attended? I mean, was he that much of a cultural touchstone?
Well, the essay that Michael referenced is titled The Game Changer. Mm. So. he literally changed the game. I mean, we had a list of photographers who we were considering to shoot, you know. At that point, we were just, you know, remaking this cover and, you know, inviting as many rappers as we could to that address and getting someone to shoot it. We had considered folks. Danny Hastings was certainly on that list because he's amazing. As were, Jonathan Mannion, my beloved Brian Cross, who shot some great covers for me at Rap Pages, and some other folk. But once Gordon Parks' name got into the mix...
That adds a whole layer of gravity to it. It really does.
And what was it that changed his mind?
Well, ultimately, I told him, you know, I put the spiel on him, you know, that we were, you know, honoring this generation of jazz musicians, you know, these geniuses, these legends who had inspired hip hop in so many ways. It's like we were returning to sort of consecrated ground, you know, with sort of their artistic offspring. I put all of these arguments in his ear, and he was like, and then I just told him, basically, you know, Mr. Parks, we could get anybody to take the picture, but, you know, the only person who should take it is you.
How active was he at that point? I mean, he was 86, more or less, I think, at that point. Was he still shooting regularly?
I think he was. I mean, I know that when Leslie called me to tell me that he said no, she said that his, you know, that he basically could pick and choose what he wanted to shoot. I guess he just didn't want to shoot a bunch of rappers. Mm-hmm. You know, I could get that. Mm-hmm. But I think that, I don't know, I think that maybe once he understood that we knew what we were asking for, you know, we knew we were getting Gordon Parks, you know, that it wasn't light to us. He wasn't just some photographer. I think that maybe, I don't know, maybe once he understood that we really understood the importance of having him shoot it, you know, we wanted from him what he was, which was his genius.
Do you think the fact that Art Kane photographed A Great Day in Harlem previously, and that had a huge impact on a lot of people, photographers and the culture and everything else, if that photograph didn't exist, do you think Mr. Parks would have partaken, or do you think that the weight of the previous photograph taken 40 years earlier added something to his decision? Because again, that would be a big factor.
I think it did. I think that, again, we made it clear to him that we knew what we were doing by going back to that address, you know, 17126. So I think he knew that that we got what we were doing in a real way. So I think he understood that we got the magnitude of that photo and what it meant.
Gotcha.
And we also made it clear that what we were creating was also an homage to Mr. Kane. You know, we wanted to continue that sort of legacy of, you know, capturing what a fulfilled promise looks like, basically. That's what he had done. That's what we wanted to do, too.
That's great. And did you know if Gordon Parks, you know, had an affinity for hip hop?
Well, he hadn't guessed it on anybody's rhymes or anything.
Well, he might have been in some rhymes, right?
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. I don't know that he probably had an affinity for hip hop. Mm-hmm. But again, I think that he got that we got how important he was.
Sure,
right.
So, sure,
you know,
sure.
The rest of it was just gravy.
And can you speak a bit about the production aspect of it? Like who you called first, who were the top of the list people you wanted involved, and how it was to get these people, who signed on right away to come for the shoot, and who took some wrangling?
We had a list of, you know, the originators, you know, Cool Herc, you know, I mean, all the folks from Sedgwick Avenue, you know, the old school artists. We just had a long list of anybody who had ever made a rap record or contributed to hip hop music in a way that was significant.
So the door was kind of open. I mean, in the sense that if somebody said, "Hey, I want so and so should be here too," did you then invite them as well?
Yes, absolutely, absolutely. And again, the fact that Gordon Parks was taking the picture gave it a particular significance now.
Did you have Mr. Parks on board before you start sending out the invites? Because obviously I think that would add a lot of weight to why one would want to be in the photograph. Or did Parks come on during the process?
No, he came on before we sent out the first invitation.
Ah, okay.
We were still considering photos when, or photographers rather, when it was suggested that he shoot it. And then we were fortunate enough to get him on board. And then once Leslie and Biff Warren got the word out, you know, with Gordon Parks attached, it was just a matter of who was around, who had made unbreakable plans. You know, it's different when you're talking about just shooting a photo, but when you're talking about Gordon Parks taking it, it's like, oh, well, all right, well, hold on.
Yep.
So, yeah. You know, there were folks who couldn't make it because of KRS-One was relocating. I remember that. And I think some folks were shooting movies that they couldn't get out of and things like that. But, you know, anyone who could get there got there, sure, because Gordon Parks was taking it.
To me, that this aspect of putting out the word and getting people there is such a fascinating part of the whole thing. Mm-hmm. Because you have to remember, this was pre-social media. This was really Leslie activating this amazing network of publicists and people, and I feel like it set off this great underground, like, sleeper cell of hip hop, you know, and word just got around, you know.
That's a good point. There was no social media. This is a whole different world.
And in some ways, if there were such social media, I wonder if that photo would have even happened, because imagine today the call goes out, you know, everyone in hip hop is going to be at 17 East 126th at such and such time with Gordon Parks photographing. You'd have more
imagine the fans too,
and fans there than artists. I mean, I think the shoot would have been a disaster, and you know, the NOI would have definitely put them in their place. But that aspect of it, I just wanted to jump in because that is so fascinating to me, that it all just, the stars all aligned.
Is there any artists particularly that were, you know, you really wanted them to be there and you had to do some arm twisting? Was there, and you don't have to go into details, but was it people were volunteering their time to come, or was there, you know, was it a paying gig for the artist that showed up, and just kind of discuss that aspect of it?
We didn't have to twist anybody's arm because Gordon Parks took the cash.
Okay.
It was like, you get to 26th Street and you get your photo taken by Gordon Parks, period. Mm-hmm. Get there or not, it's on you.
Okay.
You know, we didn't spend a dime to get anybody there.
Yeah.
I will say that the one artist that folks are most interested in being there was Rakim. He was who everybody wanted to see. But as far as our interest, we wanted the originators, and we wanted anybody who could get there who had made a rap record. You know, we knew that, you know, with hip hop, we're talking about, you know, B-boys, B-girls, DJs, graffiti writers, you know. No, we just wanted artists, just, you know, musicians, artists only. Right. And because, you know, Leslie and Biff were such astute publicists, they'd know who to target, you know, the label publicists to get, the independent publicists to get, the industry blabbermouths who'd run their mouths. And again, we're talking even pre-internet. So right. We're talking phones and snail mail, right. You know?
And beepers.
Beepers, yes.
Yeah, hello. Beepers. Oh, my God. The two-way. Hello. So, yeah.
I forgot about them.
I should have said that earlier.
Beepers. Yes, the pages, they were in effect.
Yeah.
So, yeah, we just wanted whoever could get there, whoever could get there to get there. And that's what they did.
And can you talk a bit about... you know, securing the location and Alan's question earlier about, you know, the security elements and the production elements. And then maybe we can, Michael, you can chime in on some of the, we'll talk about how it was when you were there that day.
Oh, sure. Well, Leslie and Biff did, you know, they secured the city permits and all of that. Hmm. But we just went up there and looked at the address, saw where it was. And then we went looking for a church on the block that we could use that day, basically. And we found one right on the corner of Madison and 126, and that was our home base. And it was great. That day, actually, Biff, Leslie, and I went up to the church. We met with one of the staff workers there. Leslie and Biff then went back and met with the pastor of the church at another time. But we went up there, we talked security right there. We all sort of suggested Invasion of Islam, you know, because they're always perfect security. And that's all it was.
So everybody gathered basically at the church beforehand. It wasn't like everybody just slowly showed up in front of these, the brownstones, that you gathered first beforehand as a group and then you went over right. As a group?
Right, right.
Okay.
That was sort of... Sort of the plan. Go ahead.
I was going to say, Sheena's leaving out one of the best parts was whoever catered the lunch. And there was this big lunchroom downstairs. And, you know, so you're sitting downstairs and you're looking around this lunchroom and it's like Africa Mbata's over there. And it was surreal, right. You know, it was like Fellini hip hop or something. It was like some...
Yeah, that was actually something else. We had catering from Sylvia's, of course.
Yeah.
And yeah, because they were nearby. The conveniences were amazing. But we had everybody up in the second floor community room of this huge church. And it was like being in an airport when in the arrival section, when people come off the plane and they see people, you know, the folks who there arrive and they haven't seen each other. And there's the reunion and the hugging and all of that, you know, times 20 in this room. Just lots of reunion moments. Yeah. And, hey, and, that was fantastic.
Were there any... go ahead.
No, please. Go. No, that's why the shoot... I think we started later. We hadn't anticipated all of this sort of emotion. We didn't take that into account in our planning because folks were at the church. They didn't want to leave the church to get down the block, you know? And so it took a while to get everybody assembled, but it was... not a problem because there was no problem on that block that day. It was just nothing but love.
That's great. That's great. And were there any photographers working that community room, getting behind the scenes shots?
I think we had some photographers from XXL, and Nelson George was filming for his documentary.
Right.
So we had some folks up there shooting.
Was this the biggest production that you guys had put together at this point? I mean, obviously it's a really big production, but like, were you guys used to large scale photo shoots?
Well, I think this was the biggest one that XXL had done. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, and even with, but my other publications that I had worked at, it was the biggest just by virtue numerically in terms of how many people were on the cover. Production wise, you know, it was just sort of holding down that block and keeping folks contained on that church. And then with the fans who came out, although there weren't that many, actually, most of the fans who came out were celebrities and other, you know, fan, you know, kind of famous folk who knew that it was going and they came out there because they wanted to see folks.
Right.
But, Yeah, that was sort of the biggest production element, was just getting folks down from the church.
What about the lining up of people, you know, the assembly? And was there people who wanted to be next to each other and accommodations that had to be made? And who did that organizing?
No, not a single one. It was like, get up there, get on the stoop. Hmm. As a matter of fact, Nelson George's documentary shows folk with the bullhorn trying to get people up on the stoop. And that was an adventure in itself.
On that note, I was reading about Art Kane's original photograph, and he apparently had a hard time containing this smaller group. There was a lot of talking going on. Not only that, there was some production issues going on, so it took a little bit longer, and like little kids start showing up and sitting on the curb, and apparently there was one kid, a kid in one of the windows who was distracting everything, and Kane finally gave up of trying to maintain control and just started shooting. Did you have similar issues going on 40 years down the line?
No, actually we didn't. We had some, you know, kids that we wanted to sort of get on that curb because we were trying to recreate the photo, even with the kids sitting down. But at that point, we were just trying to get the picture taken before the sunlight had gone up into people's faces.
Oh, I was going to come to that. I know that Kane specifically called for a 10 a.m. shoot because he knew where the sun was going to be. It's the north side of the block, and you have X amount of time before that shadow creeps up. And I watched some of there were some YouTube videos, I believe it was, of your production. And you could see, I immediately started watching this shadow crawling across north up 126th Street. I could almost hear the soundtrack from Jaws in the background. You know, bum 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 bum. And seriously, the final photograph, the front row of guys, they're literally up to their necks in shadow. And another 10 minutes later, you would have lost them. Were people freaking out about that?
I believe they were. Yes. I can't remember the call time, but I'm pretty sure it was early.
But I don't think you shot until about 1 or something like that,
no,
right?
No, it was actually shot like 3:30 or 4 o'clock. Okay.
Exactly.
In other words, lunch was good, is what you're saying. Okay. Yeah.
Exactly. Between the lunch, the emotion, all of it. But yeah, I think that the call time was early because they had actually scoped out and taken that shadow into consideration.
Yeah.
But at that point, we were just trying to get her done for real. It was like, okay, get down there. We have to get it done. And they were freaking out, but... you know, there's nothing they could do. We just had to get it done.
No, I believe also in the day that Kane shot, based on the shadow, it looked like it was slightly overcast, which worked in everybody's favor. But you guys had glaring sunlight. That was bright, harsh light.
It was a gorgeous day, though. I mean, it was so beautiful that day.
Alan, I just wanted to tell you one quick thing about the placement. Like, the only story that I've heard is that Questlove, he actually writes about this in his foreword to Contact High, that he had asked Sheena where the fold of the magazine was going to be because it folded out, and he wanted to make sure that wherever he stood in the photo, he'd be on the front cover and not on the fold or on the inside. Is that so?
That is a big consideration.
Mm-hmm. Well, I thought that was... to have that forethought, I thought was really interesting.
That's me with a staple in my forehead.
That's hilarious. Oh, my God. And, you know, Questlove, by the way, was the only artist who came with a camera to shoot film. So he had some real foresight that day.
Yeah. And he also, you know, writes about that's the day they finished mastering Things Fall Apart that day. And that day was so interesting, too, because... you know, that was a Tuesday. A lot of albums were being released that day, and some of those artists came, right? Black Star.
Yeah.
Tribe.
Tribe was there.
They were there. Jay released Hard Knock Life, Volume 2, right? But he was not there. Brand Nubian released Foundation, and they were there. But just, you know, this so much happened on that day.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that actually kind of gets me to a point that, and maybe I'm wrong on this, but, you know, the jazz photo was 58. Rock and roll was taking over as the popular music. But 98 was probably a pinnacle point, no, for hip-hop. Wouldn't that be fair to say? I mean, or maybe a trend, like kind of between the first golden age and going into a second golden age. So the question that might come out of that, were there any, you know, young guys and girls who might not have been that well known, but have grown since to become iconic hip hop artists. And any back and forth between the old school and the new school guys?
I would say like Mos Def and Talib and those guys. I mean, they were young. I mean, Black Star, like
that
you
was
said,
their first album.
That was their first album. I didn't. I mean, I knew who Mos Def was because Devin Roberson was working with him, but I don't. You know, other than that, I didn't really know his work. And now he's like one of my favorite rappers. So.
Yeah. Well, and that. Yeah. I mean, Sheena, you probably know more, but one thing in watching Nelson George's footage of that day that I thought was just really touching was like Mos Def being a total fanboy of Rakim and being like, oh my God, am I here? Look, there's Rakim, there's so-and-so. And then, yeah, if you think like nowadays people would be having that same sentiment about him, but 98 was a big year, right? It was, you definitely had that established originals, you know, legends that were there. And then you had this new school, that was really coming up and releasing albums and experimenting. And a lot of it too was experimenting with like jazz samples. So also referencing the, you know, Art Kane moment. Mm-hmm. So yeah, I mean, Sheena can probably speak more, but what stands out to me is like Mos Def just really. Huh.
Was there anybody that you really wanted there that didn't make it or was scheduled and had to pull out the last minute? And looking back, it's like, oh, I really wish they had been there.
Oh, the only two particular folk, Lauryn Hill was late. She got there right as a photo was being taken, so she didn't make the shot. Oh. And
she didn't make the lunch either.
And Run from DMC, Joseph Simmons, is actually running up the block, as Nelson George's documentary shows. And he made it into the photo he made it up to the shoot, but he didn't make the final shot. You know, he's on the proof sheet somewhere.
I noticed there were two cameras that Mr. Parks used. He shot with a Nikon. I couldn't figure out what lens it was on it. And a Fuji 617, which is a wide field camera. It's like a 3-to-1 aspect ratio, or more than that. Which camera took the actual photographs that made it? Or was it a combination of both?
I can't even guess.
It must be the wide. Right, because yeah, I don't think you can take. I don't think the Nikon would have had that.
Well, it depends what lens you have, and then you just crop top and bottom. I wasn't sure. There's ways of faking all that stuff.
So I actually asked in the research for the book. I asked the Gordon Parks Foundation was kind enough to give me, you know, the contact sheet, which has 4 frames on it, and you can actually see the creep up of the shadow on it, which is great.
Could you hear the shark music as you're looking at the contact?
Yes, that's going to be in the special edition of the book.
The 3D version.
Yes.
The VR version one day.
What are those little Hallmark cards that when you open it up, they start playing the music? Right. Like, we're going to... I asked, you know, the foundation if they had any records on like the specifics of that day. And unfortunately, there's just more research to be done, I think, on the specifics. And I would love, you know, eventually to talk to his assistants from that day and find out more. But they were not sure which specific camera.
Okay.
Yeah.
One of the things I wanted to comment on was when you were talking about was Gordon shooting. I mean, it was kind of interesting because he was shooting mostly flowers. Like he had this big, in the retrospective, you know, after years of being this life photographer and, you know, shooting everything, he was like shooting flowers and stuff like that. And so maybe that was one of the reasons why he didn't want to do the photograph at first because he didn't want to work with people anymore. I mean, I don't know. I remember even though Sheena and Leslie were quite optimistic, I didn't think it was going to happen at all. I was just like,
you mean the whole photograph?
The whole photograph. I mean, I couldn't imagine how they were going to get all these rappers to actually stand in one place. And, you know, so Leslie and I lived together and she left early and I told her I wasn't coming. And then like maybe around 10 o'clock, I was like, I must be crazy. I was like, I'm going to miss this. And so I jumped in the cab and went up to 126th Street. And I'm just glad I did, because it was one of the greatest days. I mean, I remember two things I remember was talking to Rakim, and Rakim talking about how the reason he was there was because of Gordon Parks. Uh-huh. And he was such a big, you know, Rakim comes from a jazz background and all this, so he knew, and he was like, that I came, I remember him even at one point over on the side talking to Gordon Parks. Now, whether or not Gordon Parks knew who he was or not, but they were having a conversation. I also remember Blondie, Deborah Harry, and Chris Stein showing up. And I have interviewed rappers for years, but to see those guys who I loved since I was a teenager was, and our friend Amy Linden, who was there, she knew those guys, and she asked Chris Stein, they're like, is there anybody you want to meet? And Chris Stein said, I want to meet Mobb Deep. Is Mobb Deep here? So, I mean, that happened. I did, like, a couple months later, I think on the American Music Awards, Blondie did a collaboration with Mobb Deep. But I just remember the day being, like, just wonderful. I mean, I'm from Harlem. You know, I write a lot about Harlem, you know, so I feel a part of it. And to be a part of that history was just thrilling.
And just a little thought to throw in here. I was reading up again about how Art Kane came around to this whole thing. And he chose that block for a few. He actually cruised around there a lot looking for something. He wanted to have a street and a few row houses that were typical of Harlem. That was one thing. He also wanted a location that was within walking distance of many of the people who appeared in that photograph. And a lot of those jazz greats, literally, they lived within a few blocks. And it was also a block away from a subway station. So he actually had convenience.
And I think, a couple, like Big L was in the photo, came from not too far.
I have to say, did someone walk over there themselves?
Yeah. Sure. Yeah, there were like a lot of Harlem-based artists.
Jump me back a bit. Can you tell me, when did you start production? How long ahead of time did the idea come? And how long was it in the works before the day of the shoot?
Well, we actually, we kicked around the idea to make it happen like in spring of 98. That's when the meeting was where somebody brought it up. Mm-hmm. And then once we discovered that it was the 40th year anniversary of Jazz Portrait, the picture, we're like, no, we have to do it. Yeah. But instead of just doing it for whatever random month's cover, we moved it to the year end. Mm-hmm. So, yeah.
And from when Gordon Gordon Parks was on board until the shoot was how long?
Let me think. The exhibit that you referenced, Michael, the Half Past Autumn, was still going on when he said yes. And it must have been what, summer? So spring into summer, and we shot it September 29th. So, okay. Yeah.
A couple of few months. How about the neighborhood? Yeah. I mean, obviously, there's a building that's boarded up and closed down in the 98 photo. What was the block like at that time? And how about the neighbors? Did people come out? I mean, you mentioned that there wasn't a lot of people there. But the reception was good, and it was kind of a block party.
Yeah, it pretty much was a block party. Mm-hmm. But the three stoops that are being used in the photo, one of them was covered up via brick, I believe.
Yeah, it was cinder blocks.
Yeah, cinder blocks, and the other two, I don't know. You know, I don't know that they were. What folks trying to get in and out. Well, we went up there to scope it out. I don't know that there were anybody. We didn't have to talk to any of the neighbors, mm-hmm. you know. But again, Leslie and Beth went and got the city permits and what have you. So it wasn't an issue for any of that. And mm-hmm. any of the kids on the block were out on the block just enjoying the day like everybody else. Mm-hmm. Of course, it happened to be a Tuesday, so most kids were at school. So mm-hmm. it all, you know, it was gravy. I know that we had some of the photos that we took, there were children in the pictures. And some of the artists who participate actually brought their kids.
Right.
So there are a few out there. And then again, folks, a lot of the publicists who came, folks from different press outlets, you know, other magazines and media came out too. So
was there anybody there from who was there at the original shoot, Art Kane's shoot, people that showed up later on, 40 years later, like any of the little kids that came back as adults? Seriously, I mean, no, why not?
I feel like this story could go on and on. Like, and I do want, there is one baby in the shoot, which is being held by the original Jazzy Jeff, not the Jazzy Jeff in the Fresh Prince, but the original Jazzy Jeff is holding his baby, and he's credited as Jazzy Jeff's baby. And I was just having a conversation with someone the other day. I was like, we have to find that baby because that baby's 22.
Yeah.
Now.
He's probably hanging out with the baby from the Nirvana cover, right?
The baby from the Biggie cover. Let's find all the babies on the next episode.
So can we then jump back to that question I had earlier about maybe the reception to the photo from the public at large, Gordon Parks, the artists that were involved. Any comments from Michael or Sheena on that?
Michael has spoken to artists over the course of the years, and you know they've had some wonderful things to say about that day. And even in the coverage, because this was the year-end photo, Harry Allen and Miles Marshall Lewis got some really good recollections of artists of that day and what it meant to them. I wish I had it in front of me, but I know that Michael's spoken to some folk. So who knows?
At the time, I was working with the Experience Music Project, the museum in Seattle, and they had me write a big story about that day. It was kind of like an in-house magazine that they had. As a magazine junkie, I mean, I've been a fan of magazines since I was a kid. I couldn't wait to have the physical issue in my hand. Mm-hmm. I don't know if I bought it on a newsstand or if Leslie brought it home or whatever. I just couldn't wait to have the picture, you know, folded out. And, you know, I mean, it was wonderful. Actually, I have two of them. I lent one out, though. I hope I get it back.
Oh, that was a bad move. You didn't learn, did you?
You know, I try to be nice with these things, but I still have one copy. I wish I had a copy of the poster, though. Hmm. I believe, Sheena, wasn't there a poster inside?
There was a poster inside. I think some of the issues were packaged with a poster. I don't know if they all were, but some of them were.
Yes, yes. And I think Vikki was telling me that Jay-Z has like the original Gordon Parks print of the picture in his house or one of his houses or something. Did you tell me that?
I don't think that was me, but that's cool if he does.
I heard that rumor. I heard that. I mean, I can't confirm it, but I did hear that too.
We'll give him a call.
Yeah. But I think, you know, nowadays I feel like hip-hop's so mainstream and everyone writes about it. And at the time, you know, someone like Gordon Parks came from this generation of, you know, Look magazine and Life and even magazines like Essence, Jet. You know, you think about those. And it's interesting to think about all the hip-hop magazines, why they were being born at that time. I mean, XXL came a little later, but, you know, The Source, things like Ego Trip, things like, you know, independent media that were publishing photos of hip-hop. I mean, I hear a lot from the photographers that I've interviewed for the book that, you know, they would go to these mainstream publications and be like, hey, I have this photo of Rakim or, you know, whatever. And, like, people weren't really checking for it.
They didn't care at all.
And same, you know, same goes for a lot of this generation of writers and editors. And now I think, you know, we take it so for granted because it's really risen to power. But that time in history, too, you know, when you talk about media and the kind of coverage and who was writing about what, it's important just to pause and say, like, this was a big, like, entrepreneurial moment in hip-hop publishing, in these really young writers and photographers and editors, you know, having this DIY moment of starting magazines, starting, you know, really writing about the culture for themselves. And in this time when you talk about who writes about what, like, they created this whole... not just the culture, but the media around it, you know. Yeah. And, you know, I think, you know, you think of like Sheena is a, you know, a female editor of a hip hop magazine, and there were women, and we were like, everyone was so young. And I just think that's so powerful, you know, and people like Leslie, like so many women were behind this day too.
Mm-hmm.
And I just wanted to like take a minute to celebrate that, because it's something I think that's taken for granted now, but it was really a generation defining itself in that moment. And I think also, you know, I'm not going to speak for Mr. Parks, but I think because he came from that previous generation, I would have been fascinated to know if his hesitation had anything to do with him not feeling part of this new wave that was happening, if there was any kind of generational thing happening too. Because obviously hip hop had this great adoration and respect for him, but at the same time there was a little bit of a disconnect happening in, you know, media and this art form that was still not taken super seriously by a lot of people who were gatekeeping media at the time.
Okay, we're going to take a short break, but first we're going to say goodbye to Sheena. Thank you so much for joining us today. When we come back, we're going to be joined by Fab Five Freddy. Stay tuned.
We hope you're enjoying this edition of the B&H Photography Podcast. Send us a tweet at BH Photo Video, hashtag BH Photo Podcast.
Okay, we are back, and not only are we back, we are going to be joined by creative and visual artist and filmmaker Fab Five Freddy. Welcome, sir.
Hey, how are you? Happy to be here.
It's great to have you on here. We've been talking for the past hour or so about that big day 20 years ago. Can you share some of your recollections of how that day went down and things that might have stood out to you?
Well, yeah, you know, I don't know if you guys have seen the essay that I wrote for Vicky's book, Contact High, but yeah, it was, which, you know, a chunk of the essay dealt with that. And it was like a memorable day when I got a call, like from one of the producer that I used to work with on Yo MTV Raps, Jack Benson, said, "Hey, Fab, are you aware of this big photo shoot going on in Harlem?" I said, "No, what's happening?" And something to the effect of them doing a version of that legendary jazz photo, which I knew well because my dad was a jazz head. Max Roach was my godfather, the great bebop drummer. So I was well aware of that photo, had seen it, had watched my dad and his friends pore over it numerous times, picking out different guys, how amazing it was that all these guys were able to be brought together. So I was like, wow, I know it well. And so I was like, "Yeah, man, let's set up to Harlem to take, you know, to see what's going on." And then when we got there was this amazing group. I think I described it as like a block party, like a classic New York block party with like hip hop luminaries from then to now. I mean, from Kool Herc all the way to whoever had hot records at the moment. We're all like on this block in Harlem. I can't remember what it was, 126 or whatever.
126.
And everybody was just, everybody was hugging each other and talking and catching up. It's whatever. Anytime hip hop people get together, like from various eras, it's just like a love fest. How you been? How you doing? What's up? Everybody's fans of each other. And that literally was what was going on. And then there was my hero, Gordon Parks, on the other side of the street. And I was like in awe moment for me, because Gordon Parks has been my, you know, creative cultural hero since I was a kid and found out who he was, you know, going to see Shaft and all that kind of stuff. So he was on my radar, and the fact that he was doing the picture, man, was just like super duper epic. He was in his 80s at the time, but still, you know, working hard and out there doing his thing. And that was that great day in That was that great day part two, I guess. 2.0.
That's a good way of putting it. I like that.
And I just want to say also, you know, because I grew up in a jazz household, there was that the really good documentary that was done about the young guys at the time. I think Art Kane, if I'm not mistaken.
Art Kane, yes.
The young staff at Esquire had the idea, and they were jazz fans, and the doc was really great in terms of showing how that photo came together. In fact, one of the jazz guys had a Super 8 film camera, if I'm not mistaken, and so there was various other footage along with the stills taken of these guys, you know, documenting the different jazz guys, you know, his actual film footage of them. That was all pretty amazing. In fact, that even there's some young kids sitting on the ground in the original photo that were adults, and they were interviewed as grown men about being, you know, the little kids on the block in the 50s when the photo was taken. So, yeah, I was well aware of the legacy around that picture and was really happy to participate in the 2.0 version.
That's great. Were you, did you get there early and hang out in the church and spend some time with people, people?
I went, I was a little early. I went in the church for a minute, but I mostly stayed on the street because I was just like everybody else. I'm seeing like a who's who of hip hop people from then and now. And I think a few years ago when looking at the photo, it hit me, and this is the point that I make in my essay, that this photo literally is the end of the golden era, because that era in hip hop, which loosely is from, I guess you'd say, mid-80s to mid-90s, and this was a period in hip hop when, you know, obviously New York dominated, but the South was happening and beginning, Cali had happened, and it was still strong. And it's just looking at the people in that photo, I realized, oh my God, this could most likely never happen again. Because the reason everybody was in town, Vibe magazine was doing their music conference, if you will. So tons of heads were in town for that. So you had Atlanta in the house, you had California in the house, you know, Chicago. I was working with a group called Crucial Conflict at the time, which were the biggest group to come out of Chicago. We had a huge hit with them. And they were there that day. I'd forgotten everybody there. But when you comb through the photo, you realize, like, why is this amazing representation of hip-hop people from coast to coast from then to now, including Kool Herc and Grandmaster Flash and all those guys, Rocksteady Crew. It was just, I mean, even Debbie Harry and Chris Stein from Blondie were there.
Mm-hmm.
Just a unique gathering of people, you know, all celebrating, you know, hip hop culture. And it would all change and, you know, evolve into where we are now.
It's interesting.
Mumble rap. Mumble rap. Mumble.
Quick question about the placement and where you were in the photo. Do you have any recollection of you know, how you were placed, where you were?
Who was next? I'm standing, I guess if you're looking at the photo, I'm a little to the left. Looking at the photo, I'm a little to the left of center.
Yeah.
And I'm kind of right behind Fat Joe and Slick Rick.
Yeah.
Kind of on the side of me. So.
All right.
Yeah.
Was there any, do you remember how you got to that spot? Were you just, someone said go over there, or you wanted to be next to somebody, or they grouped people together in any one way, or any recollection on that?
Yeah, I just was, I was going to make sure that I was going to be front and center some way, somehow, as it should be. Was there no question in that? But no, it was all good. I was just milling. I tell you, there's some video of that, and and the hardest thing was getting everybody to kind of stop the, like, love fest.
Sure.
Of everybody, like, amazed at seeing all their other people that they look up to, which is at the core of hip hop culture. Like, people admire each other. Even if you're not a big fan of the musical style, people know what it takes to kind of make an impact on this game. And the respect was being demonstrated. It was just really special. And so, you know, and then Gordon on a megaphone and assistants trying to get everybody to, like, come on guys, let's take the photo. It just was such a sweet moment. And going over to talk to Gordon was epic to me. It probably was the second or third time I'd met him, but I had to go over to make sure that he actually knew and he acknowledged me. I'm friends with, you know, a couple of Gordon's kids. Leslie Parks is a buddy, and definitely like I said, I've been a huge fan of his work since Shaft and since I realized that he was the, you know, the model of the Renaissance man. Anybody that wants to, you know, excel in different creative formats you want to take a close look at, because Gordon did it all and did it well, you know, filmmaker, composer, writer. I mean, you know, director, photographer. I mean, come on. That's it, baby.
You think that everybody who was there was aware of the original photo and kind of understanding this place in history?
Yeah. I mean, you know, film heads, people, I mean, I'm sure there was some that knew. That's a good question, by the way. But I think, once again, it was the idea, like, once again, everybody was in town for what was one of many music conferences, which would bring everybody together, label execs, artists, etc. But I, once again, I knew, I'm sure Nelson George and people like that knew, I'm sure Michael Gonzales knew, you know,
yeah.
us like hardcore culture nerds had been aware of it. Because that film had came out just probably a few years before,
right. Yep.
The documentary. And I remember going to the film forum to see it, and it was like, you know, extremely well done.
Yeah, I was there too. By the way, Gene Bach is the filmmaker there. It's called The Great Day in Harlem, for people who want to look it up. Michael, Vikki, do you guys have any questions? Anything you want to...
Well, I was going to say, I remember when everybody was going to the block, I believe Freddy, Nelson George, and Russell Simmons were the guys who were kind of corralling everybody.
Oh, yeah.
You know, and looking at Russell, you know, I mean, this guy is like this multimillionaire, whatever, and he's like just taking part into this whole thing that he was helping get people to the location.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And...
I was just going to add, you know, Harlem itself. I mean, Fred, I know that's where you live now. How have you seen that neighborhood change over time and kind of compare it to what it is today versus, because now that, those brownstones, I walked by there not too long ago. I mean, they're all like beautifully redone.
The cinder blocks are gone.
The cinder blocks are gone, you know.
Well, that's a good point because, you know, I was, I hadn't even brought my house in Harlem yet. So that's a really interesting point. And I'm a part of the gentrification of Harlem. It's, you know, whether that's good or bad, that's a debatable issue. But, I've been living in Harlem now since the early 2000s, and it's hard to find, an abandoned building in Harlem right now. Things have changed dramatically as far as that goes. And a lot of people used to be scared of Harlem because of the negative press that was given to places where people of color live in this city.
Harlem had just gone through the crack era. You know what I'm saying? So, mm-hmm. I mean, I lived in Harlem most of my life. I moved out of Harlem in 92 and it was still going through, you know, the quote-unquote crack era. You know, for people who don't know, I mean, there were a lot of abandoned buildings. A lot of neighborhoods were, you know, not what they were even 20 years before. So, you know, when you look at that building and you see that it's all kind of boarded up, I mean, you know, the crack era had mostly ended, but it was still hanging out, you know? I don't think it really got better until, like, maybe, like, 5-10 years later.
Exactly, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Anyone know what that building is? I mean, I guess there's owners and people living there. Vikki, have you been up there?
I'm glad you bring that up because last time I was there, which was about 3 weeks ago, mm-hmm. I walked on that block and they have a commemoration to a great day in jazz. And there's a small plaque that says, you know, on this location, on this date, photographer Art Kane photographed. And I was like, where's the Gordon Parks Great Day in Hip Hop mention? And there is absolutely none. Yeah. And I thought, you know, after, I'm like, I feel like this needs to be
absolutely
A, stated, and B.
Yeah, that's a good point, Victoria. That's a very good point.
At the very least, take a Sharpie and go write it in.
Well, no, I think we need to do more than that. So this, I mean, having this conversation today, celebrating this anniversary and just bringing attention to, you know, this next generation of artists that created that too, I think we need to call the mayor's office and get that changed.
So, Fred, can I ask, at the time and now looking back 20 years, did you know at the moment that that was a very special day, let's put it that way, and something that was going to be looked back at 20 years from now, or was it just kind of another shoot?
Well, as far as I'm concerned, I knew it was important. How important it would end up being. But I knew it was a cover shoot, so seeing the cover and the fact that it was a three-part sold-out, that was pretty incredible. I don't know if y'all had ever did something like that. And it was, you know, once again, quite impressive. And if anybody, you know, thanks to the magic of Google, which we were probably in the infancy of, if you Google those things, you know, pretty much both pictures come up. So for those kids that are curious or stumble across it or whatever, they're kind of joined at the hip, if you will, thanks to the magic of search engines, is what I found. Because I looked it up when it hit me a few years ago, pulled it up on Google, and I'm looking at the image, and I thought, wait a minute, you know, the golden era, which is a much discussed period in hip hop, and that was it. And there's and also I think what the golden era is emblematic of is the unity and love to hip hop. Even though we went through the quote unquote East Coast, West Coast war, that was a media affectation that didn't really exist in full trueness. You know, that was something where the media threw gasoline on that when Tupac and Biggie and all that, and they whipped it up into something that really didn't exist. Whenever those artists would get together, it's a hug fest. You know what I mean? And that's what was going on that block, but things would soon change.
That's
things would change.
I was just going to say that's a big point. We, you know, as we were talking about who was there, who wasn't there, I mean, it had been really recent that both Biggie and Tupac were killed. I mean, that was 96, and this was just 2 years
correct.
Later. So
96 and 97, respectively.
Yes.
Tupac first, and then Biggie.
Right. And so this was really soon. And so the community was really feeling this great loss of these two greats. And so to come together and really have all that love, you know, Fred brings up a great point that it was really hurting at the time. And so that was a beautiful thing to see everyone come together like that.
Was there a quick question? I mean, I know Gordon Parks, obviously somebody where you had met, but you were looking forward to seeing and meeting. Was there anybody else up there that you know, you were hoping it was going to be there and they were there, or on the other side, somebody you met that day, maybe a youngster that kind of blew your mind, or someone you're still listening to these days? Any recollections of on individual people?
Well, I think the excitement, I think, for everybody was who else was there. Once again, Chris Stein and Debbie Harry from Blondie, these are people that I introduced to hip hop when it was literally like when it was still an infant, and they believed in me, supported me, and made a record called Rapture, which was, you know, first record with rap in it, not hip hop, record with rap in it to go number one all over the place and set the table for a lot of the rest of us that were there. I mean, way before I would even be hosting your MTV Raps, you know, once that happened, people were like, wait a minute, you that guy that Blondie and them was talking about. But that was significant. You know what I'm saying? Like, a lot of people heard that name, and they didn't know what a Fab Five Freddy was. You know what I mean? But at the point, it was like pieces of a puzzle that they were able to figure out where it fits once your rap hit the air coast to coast, you know, worldwide, and then all these things. And the fact that they were there, as well as just, once again, you know, Coke LaRock and Clark Kent. Those were some of the first guys to rock a mic, like, while Kool Herc was spinning at those first parties, as this idea of hip-hop was actually being hip-hop music, that is. So the fact that those guys came, I mean, you don't see those guys at your typical rap gatherings, you know what I'm saying? So it was like a strong street buzz went out, the classic grapevine, pre-internet, people were still using pages at that time. It's like, if you was technologically with it, you had a 1-800 Sky page on your hip. And you remember those. You know, and that thing went beep, 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 and you checked the number, sure. And then you had to go to a payphone to call somebody. You know, that was where we were at that point in time. But it all worked. And people came out the woodwork. until people were there. That's you know great. What I mean?
That's so awesome. Yeah.
There's a great part in some of Nelson's footage where you see they're interviewing Rakim, and in the background is this gentleman named Dino DeValle, who was an A&R person and who signed Cash Money to Universal. But at the time, I think he was working at Payday still. And he has this gigantic brick phone.
No, and he was actually at MCA. He was working,
was A&R. Was he at Universal
he
already?
He was A&R okay. and, on Rakim's solo album.
Okay, so that's why they were there. And he and I used to work at Payday together. That's why I recognized him in the background.
Yeah.
That's right. And Dino just, you know, I think he was one of the few people there. He was just really feeling himself for having this giant brick phone. And he's, you know, as Rakim's being interviewed, you see him in the background, like, on the phone, like, yeah, I got this phone.
Looking like Crockett and Tubbs.
I still have a shoulder injury from my phone.
Oh, my gosh. Yeah.
No, you're right. Actually, Dino was working at Universal at the time because we did our label deal for Crucial Conflict through Universal, and Dino was a part of that shit. He was up there at that time, so he had transitioned and was getting a little bit more money. And without question, Universal was paying that phone bill, because cell phone bills back then were ridiculous. Remember, like, all the plans, data, and stuff we planted now had not come into the picture. So literally had to be balling. You
know, shout out Dino and pagers.
Great.
Yes, I remember it well. You know, I can remember kids in the hood trying to front who didn't have cell phones, but they would take the cordless phone from the house and walk around and act like they was talking, trying to impress girls. I remember busting a couple of cats. I'm like, dude, I'm not gonna put you on blast, but I got that same phone at home. For real.
Fred, thank you so much for joining us. Terrific talking with you.
Oh man, thank you. And and look, the final thing I want to say is, for anybody that doesn't know about Gordon Parks, Google him, because, you know, everybody should recognize, you know, the great Renaissance man of the 20th century. Google him. And contact High. Get a copy. Get your order yours now.
Okay. That was a ton of fun and different from many of our podcasts around here. Nice little refreshing change of pace here. Vikki, would you tell us about the book that's coming out on
October 16th.
Yeah.
It comes out.
And that is Contact High, A Visual History of Hip Hop.
Yes.
And by the way, we have an advanced copy here. It's a nice book. It's big. It's packed full of wonderful imagery. Really, really great stuff. And as we said earlier, the pages lie flat when you open it, right? So
it's well made. You know,
beautifully printed. Really nice.
There's also some great essays in there right here.
Yes.
There are.
Yes. Yes.
And Vikki wrote a lot of the book, which is, I mean, like, that was one of the things we were talking about, looking at the book and just seeing. I can't wait to dive into that book for real.
Yeah. Well, and, you know, that's the thing. Like, I think behind every photograph is a really great story. And behind every photograph is also contact sheets where you visualize who else was there and, you know, what was happening in the frames before and after. And it's a way to really tell the deeper stories of hip hop and the people that were involved in it.
It's a very complete document is really the way I look at it. It's there's a lot there. You can get lost on every page. You really can.
I want to ask one question, and this might be a weird question, but do people still use contact sheets?
Not really. I mean, Not in the way that they were once used, because they were really, you know, a working object,
right,
for people. But
right,
nowadays, people make them for fun.
It's all on the screen.
Yeah, but maybe we'll bring it back.
Yeah.
But so the book comes out October 16th. It's a chronological, you know, unfolding of the past 40 plus years of hip hop photography and photographers and the stories behind them, really great essays. Questlove wrote the foreword. Michael Gonzales wrote the story about Great Day in Hip Hop, as did Fab. RZA contributed an essay about his inspiration for Wu-Tang visuals. Young Guru wrote an essay. DJ Premier from Gangstar, which is someone that I used to work with for many of their photo shoots in the early 90s. He wrote a great essay. And then Rhea Combs, who's the photography curator of the Smithsonian African American History and Culture Museum, also contributed an essay. So from, you know, the writing to the imagery to the photographer stories, I really hope that this will be a book that can serve the culture and the moment. Yeah, and just tell the bigger story that I'm just so proud to come together with everyone to tell. And, you know, Great Day, as I was deciding which photos would be in there, of course, Great Day was a no-brainer. And November 7th at Schomburg Center, we're going to host a talk and a celebration about that photo. We'll have the book there. We'll have a great panel. Michael and Sheena and Fab will also be part of the panel. So anyone who's listening and wants to come, Schomburg Center, November 7th, we will celebrate
even
more.
Not too far from where the photo was taken, too.
Correct. And that's why, yeah, and that makes it even more special, having it in Harlem, just a few blocks from where that photo was taken.
Michael, yourself, anything exciting happening these days?
Not that I can think of.
Just make something up.
I'm still writing. Been writing for Long Reads and Wax Poetics and
Paris Review.
Oh, yes, in the Paris Review. And, so I'm going to be doing more work coming up for Long Reads. I just did a big story, on Lauryn Hill, because mm-hmm. a couple weeks ago was the 20th anniversary of her, milestone album, Miseducation, yes. So I did a big story on that for Long Reads. And, so I'm just, still doing journalism and essays and that kind of thing.
Good.
Mm-hmm.
Cool beans. Okay. They say life is short, so what better reason to not miss a single episode of our show? You're not a subscriber? All you have to do is head on over to Apple Podcasts, Overcast, Spotify, Player FM, SoundCloud, or YouTube. Subscribe and never miss a single episode of our podcast. And when you subscribe, you also gain access to over 100 past episodes. How much does it cost? Nada. It's free, so log on and sign up. For now, on behalf of all of us here in the studio, thank you so much for joining us today.